He has only 16 hours to set up McCartney's multi-million dollar stage.
I'm carrying 46 men.
10 truck drivers.
On the road with me.
5 carpenters.
I hire another. I'm missing a man. 50 union stagehands.
7 sound men.
I've got one of the best road crews out.
32 feet.
The 515 is what you're making. Right?
It's got to be right here.
For Paul McCartney, when he walks on that stage,
4,200 pounds.
It needs to be identically the same every day.
It's got to be flush.
As long as he feels comfortable and confident with his stage, then the only thing he's concerned with is giving a good performance to his audience.
Yeah, downstage again for this one.
Downstage is good.
We're real safety conscious of this stuff out here.
Go! Tell me about your grid that you're going to put up here. How much weight are you actually putting up in the air?
With all the lighting and the sound and everything up there, we'll be hanging about 32 tons.
32 tons? That's a lot of weight.
Yeah.
Of course, you got Paul McCartney who's going to be standing under it. You've got to do it right, huh?
Paul McCartney or anybody, really. I'm standing under it, too.
Well, Chris, it's 7 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
Every truck come in accounted for? You got
all the trucks are here. We unloaded 4 last night. We have 6 more to go.
When do you sleep again?
After the show tonight.
Oh, you'll stay up all the way?
Yeah. I drink a lot of coffee and smoke too many cigarettes. I have some more of my lighting people arriving now.
What number is that that's bouncing, Lauren?
12 o'clock and we don't have a speaker in the air.
This is the one that was used on the last Beatles tour. Probably the most valuable instrument I've ever touched.
These guys are different. In another era, they'd have been cowboys, or they'd have been pirates. No one knows, no one really cares who these guys are, their names, their faces, anything else.
I'm just cleaning up microphones so they don't smell nasty.
Number one guitar he uses throughout most of the show.
Everybody's still nervous about each gig, you know? We're all anticipating any problem might arise. We want it to be perfect every night.
All set?
What kind of toll does this job take on you and your men?
How long until we go up to testing height?
A lot of people think it's a glamorous type of job and it's hanging out with rock stars and things.
So we can go up to testing height in about 10 minutes?
But you give up your personal life. We travel, we work hard. A lot of the guys have left wives, family, everything else at home, and you leave them at home for anywhere between a month to 6 months. It's tough because the only free time a lot of these guys have is late at night. And late at night, you got a choice of going to sit in your hotel room or down to the bar.
I was convinced I wouldn't be touring when I was, you know, over 30, and I'm 35 and I'm still doing it.
There is a heavy emotional toll, yeah. My own marriage has just fallen apart, for want of a better word. It happens to a lot of us. It's one of the diseases of the job.
We're getting the final preparations for a sound check right now.
You on schedule, Chris?
Yeah.
Two. You still worried?
Yeah.
Still worried?
Always. Now we'll just be working on the sound purely.
How's that other mic?
Okay?
He wants to do his perfect show up there. I want to do mine down here.
Yeah! Yeah, we're in good shape. Just another one of those long days. Yeah.
It's not like we have to become famous or we want to be famous, but we know in ourselves what we've done. And at the end of the night, when you get that big applause, that's for us too.
Oh, yeah. 30 minutes.
All right, let's go.
Yeah.
You know what the crew calls you?
Don't ask.
No. Some of them call you Dad.
Dad? That's cool.
In L.A., they said Dad was doing well tonight. You're only 47, which is a young man, obviously, but...
Does it surprise you? The power of the legend today.
Well, welcome all.
Yeah, I mean, it does surprise me because, you know, really we were just kids hoping to make a break out of Liverpool, and it turned into something much more important, really.
All right, lads, that's us all checked out.
What doesn't surprise me is the fact that it's kind of lasted, because John and I put in a lot of work, man, on those songs. I mean, we were really, really keen to emulate the songwriters that we loved.
I never dreamt I'd be even in this business, much less working for the man who started it all.
They don't get much bigger than this.
No, you can't go much bigger.
In order to put Paul McCartney in the spotlight...
Go back. That one. I like that.
Rickman presides over tons of lights and lasers and computers.
It's really the state of the art.
Enough equipment.
Something for the ending here.
For the tour's co-sponsor, Visa.
General wash across the stage, so everyone's covered, and then they all go right on Paul. Each song has its own, I guess, picture or personality to it, you know, look to it. In the course of the tour, it'll be changed, it'll be refined, some colors might change, or we might change the focus, but the basic look is set and it's there. And yeah, I mean, it's scripted. Shine a blue tomorrow, let it be.
Can you think back and think how the level is?
But now, half the songs at his concerts are from the Beatle days.
Hi, how you doing?
Paul McCartney seems to have come to terms with the past. And the 12-minute film that begins each show includes two songs with John Lennon singing lead.
I feel like an Olympic champion who got a gold medal. I got a gold with the Beatles, you know. So I'm not going to kind of say, no, I didn't, or I hate them for getting me a gold. I love them. And I love what I did with them, and I'm very proud of what we did.
Paul McCartney, the man, the music, and a first-hand account of the final days of the Beatles, later on 48 Hours.
Understand, but it's really hard to explain to other people. It's kind of like he's made me throughout my life so happy that I just want to get close to that.
We love you! We love you!
That's sort of a love story also.
Yeah. If there's a fight, I'd like to fix it. I hate to see things go so wrong.
Yeah, it's something my father used to say to me. He used to say, put it there if it weighs a ton. It's like, you know, here's looking at you, kid. It's one of those.
Sing along, put it there if it weighs a ton. That's what a father said to his young son.
Put it there.
Lennon and McCartney wrote more number one hits than anybody, and with that kind of popularity...
Did I ever take you in my arms, look you in the eye, tell you that I do? Did I ever open up my heart, let you look inside?
You get those moments sort of late at night or when you're feeling sort of good, I don't know, you think, oh, you know.
There never could be a better moment than this one, this one.
You always think, well, I'm saving it up. I'll tell them one day.
One, two, three, four! Well, see, we're just 17. You'll know what I mean. And the way she looks is way beyond the bed. Yeah. Well, I'm never gonna dance with another. Woo! And I saw her standing there. Well, since I saw her standing there.
Nothing.
Illinois.
There's only blacking out.
In every show, there's the performance the audience never hears.
Standby spots 1 through 5, frame 3, 4, 6 combo. Full body. Second cue, spot 6, frame 3, headshot. Ready 1 through 5? And go.
I depend on...
How many lasers?
Out, 2 and 5 splashing out, ready, and go. Nice job.
I think it's bad for the songs.
Right.
I think it's bad for people of our generation who grew up with songs like All You Need Is Love. The song that you're proud of and you think has said something didn't mean National Panasonic.
Hey, June, don't let me down. You have found a
You know, the fans, when you sing the old song, sometimes they laugh, sometimes they're happy, sometimes they cry. But one way or the other, the songs take them back. Do the songs take you back when you're up there?
Yeah, sometimes I get a bit of a choker on them, I must say. The other night I was doing Hey Jude, and I'd just done an interview prior to that where I'd been telling someone about John's value as a co-writer. The line in Hey Jude where I say,
yeah.
seems to be paying off.
I'm still kind of in the middle of this thing, you know, I don't ever feel like it's finished. You know, I'm only 47, I'm only just begun. I'm still planning to write better songs.
Back to Chicago, see you next time! I'd like to introduce my wife, Gertrude. Not really a name.
It is a bit like leaving the army, you know, in the sense that you kind of then you go get married, you have kids. I think all of us recognize that there had to be a life after the Beatles.
Once there was a way to get back home. Once there was a way to get back. And I will sing a lullaby.
Give me.
So we left it for like about 3 or 4 months, and nothing happened. He was obviously not going to come back to the group. He was enjoying his newfound freedom. So we all decided that that was it.
And I will sing a lullaby.
You know,
what is your role? You play keyboard and tambourine. You're not a professional musician.
Well, a lot of rock and rollers, it's down to 12 bars and a bit of fun. A bit of an escapism, you know.
Was Paul worried when the tour began, if the critics didn't like it, if the people didn't turn out?
Paul likes to be liked.
So was he worried? Was
he
a little nervous?
He's been nervous ever since I met him about that kind of thing, because he wants to please. He loves his music. He wants people to appreciate it.